Diplomats have been discussing various scenarios for Gaza after the conflict is over. But there's widespread disagreement, even within Israel, about what Gaza would look like the day after.
Shuttle diplomacy. U.S. Secretary of State Antony Blinken just spent a week in the Middle East, hustling from capital to capital, consulting with Israel and other allies. He laid down some ground rules for a post-war scenario.
In today's meetings, I was also crystal clear. Palestinian civilians must be able to return home as soon as conditions allow. They must not be pressed to leave Gaza.
Not everyone in the Israeli government agrees. Two far-right ministers have called for renewed settlements in Gaza and for other countries to absorb Palestinian refugees. Defense Minister Yoav Gallant put forth his own vision earlier this month. He said no Israeli civilians would be in Gaza. Gallant said Gaza residents are Palestinian, therefore Palestinian bodies will be in charge, with the condition that there will be no hostile actions or threats against the State of Israel. He stressed that Israel would maintain overall security control in Gaza. That plan has not been backed by other members of the cabinet or by Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu. With so much disagreement, what does everyone actually want in post-war Gaza? Israel wants security from attacks and says there should be no role for Hamas. The U.S. and Saudi Arabia want the Palestinian Authority, which governs the West Bank, to also run Gaza in a united Palestinian government. The Saudis say they want to normalize relations with Israel, but that depends on the establishment of a Palestinian state. The U.S. and Saudi proposals face significant obstacles. One is the unpopularity of the PA among Palestinians. Its leader, Mahmoud Abbas, is extremely unpopular. Recent polls put him at 11%, and Hamas's popularity has grown since the war started.
Nice to see you.
Netanyahu has rejected a role for the PA as well, but he's agreed to one key U.S. demand.
Israel has no intention of permanently occupying Gaza or displacing its civilian population. Israel is fighting Hamas terrorists, not the Palestinian population.
Netanyahu has, however, repeatedly dismissed the possibility of Palestinian statehood.
Well, let's look at future options with Simon Mabon, who's Professor of International Politics at England's Lancaster University. He has a particular expertise in the Middle East. Welcome back to DW, Professor. So, medium to long term, what do you think post-war Gaza is likely to look like?
Well, I think what we will be seeing is a very, very long struggle to determine both the political nature of the post-war state, the post-occupation state, perhaps. But we'll also be dealing with a very, very long-term rebuilding process, rebuilding the key institutions, the infrastructure, the necessary features of life in Gaza. And these will go hand in hand, but they're going to be very, very complicated to go hand in hand. And how one addresses one issue will directly affect the other. They are deeply politicized issues, and it's going to be a very, very fraught, very tense struggle to try and mitigate the concerns and ameliorate the worries of everyone.
So even the day after the bombing stops, the next months, possibly even years, are still going to be miserable for people living in Gaza.
Yeah, certainly. Let's go back to before October the 7th, before those awful incidents, the terrorist attacks in Israel, the devastating bombardment. Life in Gaza was incredibly precarious. It was fraught. It was difficult. It was under an occupation. It was under a blockade. It was very difficult to get the basic things into Gaza that people needed for daily life. And right now, your package just showed that 85% of Gazans have been forced from their homes. A lot of those homes have been demolished, have been destroyed in fighting. And so there's going to be a very difficult struggle to rebuild schools, homes, hospitals, the basic infrastructure that people need, on top of the broader political issues that we've been talking about.
So let's look at political control. Hamas grown in popularity since all this happened. Poll of Palestinians in Gaza indicated that 90% of Palestinians want President Mahmoud Abbas to resign. So the US idea of the Palestinian Authority being in charge of Gaza certainly sounds like a non-starter.
Yeah, I don't think there are all that many who are in favour of Mahmoud Abbas becoming the person ruling Gaza, or at least responsible for taking the day-to-day decisions about life in Gaza. The Israelis, certainly Benjamin Netanyahu, isn't too keen on that idea. There are many who perhaps like the idea of the PA, of the Palestinian Authority, taking control over life in Gaza. But much as we're seeing in the West Bank, Abbas does not have that popular support, that popular mandate that previous leaders of the PA, of the PLO, such as Yasser Arafat had. And that is a big problem. If there is a democratic deficit or a legitimacy deficit, that makes governing, that makes politics incredibly difficult.
Final word then on Israel's place in the Middle East. As a result of everything that happened since October the 7th, it's antagonized its biggest backer, the US. It's upset countries like Saudi Arabia in the region, who'd been looking to normalize relations. And of course, there's Iran sitting there waiting for the worst to happen. How do you anticipate this conflict having affected Israel's future position in the Middle East?
I think what we're seeing is that there has been an opening up of deep-seated, latent fissures, deep schisms that have been there across the Middle East that diplomats have been working incredibly hard to address, to try and find some sort of resolution to. We see that with Saudi and Iran, their normalization. We see it with the Saudis and the Houthis. We see it with the Israelis and the Saudis. We see lots of diplomatic initiatives going on. But what's happened with October the 7th and its aftermath is that a lot of those frustrations, that anger, those tensions have come to the fore once more. Now, I do think normalization with the Saudis will take place. I think there is a lot invested in that. It's a matter of time. But for now, we are in a very precarious position where there are lots of different moving parts. There's a lot of anger, a lot of frustration, and that means a lot of combustible elements.
Thank you for that, Professor Simon Maben from Lancaster University.
Thank you.
Now let's get some analysis with Dr. Julie Norman. She's an associate professor in politics and international relations at University College London, has also authored several books about the Palestinian political resistance, and is currently writing a book on contemporary history in Gaza. Dr. Norman, what title would you give the current chapter in Gaza's history?
Well, I think one of the only words we can use right now is crisis. Obviously, this crisis started on October 7th for many Israelis, but the way that the war has been conducted since has just really been an unprecedented level of crisis for Gazans, not only in the casualty rate that we keep hearing going up every day in the headlines, but also, of course, the displacement, the rising rates of famine, of health concerns, and just a complete devastation of infrastructure in a society that is going to be very difficult to rebuild from afterwards. Right now, of course, there's also worries about crisis expanding even throughout the region. And all of these crises, of course, are just having the most effect on civilians in all of these communities. And that's something that's going to be very difficult to recover from.
Now, the current war erupted, of course, after Hamas attacked Israel on October 7th. Did you see signs of this escalation earlier?
Well, obviously, everyone who follows the Israel-Palestine conflict, this is not the first time that we've seen an episode, but the scale of the episode on October 7th, the scale of the attack, I would say, was surprising and was rather unprecedented. With that said, there have been ongoing tensions between Israel and Gaza for decades, and especially between Israel and Hamas. Over the last 15 years, we've seen a series of what are often called the Gaza Wars, starting in 2008, 2009, another very significant one in 2014, and other punctuations as well. Some of those in hindsight are much more smaller scale than what we're seeing now, but a similar sense of moving in from Israelis' perspective for security concerns, trying to go after Hamas, but at the same time devastating many civilian communities and infrastructure in the meantime. And so all these things, I would say, have been building for quite a while.
Now, let's talk about Gaza after the war. We've seen several options that are on the table there in our report. But what do you think it will look like?
It's extremely difficult to see that right now. As the report noted, there are different options that have been put forward as a result of Antony Blinken's shuttle diplomacy last week. We have seen real commitment, actually, from numerous partners in the region to assist with the reconstruction. But that's predicated on the idea that there will be some kind of pathway to Palestinian statehood. And that's something that Israel is just simply not going for right now. The U.S. would like to see some role for the Palestinian Authority, the governing body in the West Bank. But as also been noted, they are extremely weak and have very little legitimacy publicly. So I think we'll probably see a couple different phases after the war. My sense is that Israel will maintain a security presence for quite a while, probably some sort of transitional government after that. But the real question is if there's actually going to be some real substantive change that Gazans want, that Palestinians want, that could actually lead to some kind of statehood that would actually address some of the deeper roots of the conflict.
Now, do you see any circumstances under which this statehood may still happen?
I think it's very difficult to see that right now. At the same time, anytime we do have a crisis like this, we do try and look at it as an inflection point. Can this somehow change the status quo and at least get us talking in new ways about statehood, about a two-state solution? These kinds of models that honestly have been on the table for quite a while now, but have not had the momentum. I think we could maybe talk about a 3 to 5% chance of that as opposed to a 1% chance before all this. So it's still very slim. But I do think it's important to note the fact that the U.S., the Palestinian Authority, most partners in the region, most Arab states are now talking seriously about that. And it's a real question of what that might look like on the ground and what kind of buy-in it can have, most importantly, from Palestinians and Israelis.
Dr. Julie Norman there, many thanks for sharing your expertise with us.
Thank you.